Greetings Earthlings, this is an inbox review of a new kit from Meng model, the US main battle tank M1A2 Abrams Tusk 1 / Tusk 2 SEP, which is the latest US main battle tank. Now Meng have made a big deal of having enlisted the help of an Abrams expert to help them to put this together and to provide all the little details and things that the other manufacturers presumably miss. So we're going to take a look at this, and we're also going to take a look at some other items that are kind of associated with it that Meng have also come out with. First of all, there's this book, M1A2 SEP, Abrams Main Battle Tank in Detail. Now this is published by SABOT Publications in association with Meng. So obviously they've got together to try and provide some good references for their kit. But that's not all. There's also a new set of paints. These are labelled as Meng colour paints. These are the US modern vehicles colour set. You'll see that it says manufactured by AK Interactive, so I think they're just AK colours that have been rebadged. But we'll take a look at this set as well and see basically whether these sets are any good and how useful they are with this new kit. So, what do you get for your money? Well, first of all, you get this rather large box. It's got some very nice artwork on it, and it's finished with Meng's usual kind of matte varnish, so it doesn't reflect the light. It looks rather very classy. It's also, as you can tell, a very big, deep box. Again, this is to be a typical Meng thing. Most of their kits are surprisingly big when you actually pick them up and you see how deep the box is. And you'll see here, AK Interactive made the paint according to high standard and strict requirements of Meng, though presumably not high standards of English grammar. So that's the box, it's a biggie, and next up, let's crack it and see what we get. So what do you get in this big deep box? Well, you get a whole bunch of sprues. They're generally moulded in this sort of tan styrene. They're all in these plastic bags, in ones or twos. The upper hull here, with the turret shell also in the same bag. Some stowage bins and hatches on this sprue. Some suspension and wheel parts, and some Tusk armour pieces, smoke discharges, and I took two out at once there, so there's another sprue here with the hatches and commander's cupola. And some transparent parts for the commander's weapon station and periscopes and the lights. Big one piece lower hull. Some single link styrene tracks. Some etched brass and decals. And finally, a very nice looking instruction booklet. And that's your lot. So we'll look at some of the sprues in detail. This one has some side skirt parts, a Tusk 1 armour blocks, and the mounting points, the belly armour, some end parts for the Tusk armour, the commander and loader's machine guns, skate ring and armour blocks, and this sprue has some hatches here for the driver and the loader, some stowage bin parts, the trunnions for the main gun and its mantlet. Lots of nice parts here for the stowage baskets for the bustle at the back of the turret. And this is a nice slide molded bustle extension. And this is a little exhaust deflector for the rear. And here we have the engine grills, torsion bars for the idler, another skate ring, more grills and front fenders, some tow cables, more parts for the compensating idler, and these are the smoke dischargers. And now we come to the wheels. There are two identical sprues like this one that contain the road wheels and the sprockets, as well as some suspension parts. Here are the main road wheels. And close up you can see the details very nice, although these ones actually have the hubs moulded solid. On the real vehicle the hubs are actually transparent plastic, and on the Dragon kits they're actually moulded as separate transparent parts, but on this one they're moulded solid. These are the spare sprocket rings, and we get two types of sprocket here. As you can see we have the sort of scalloped one and the sort of heavier duty one with the plain ring. And also on this sprue we have the workable torsion bars, track return rollers, some tail lights, various pieces of towing gear, CIP panels, and some supports here for the bazooka plates. This sprue contains parts for the Tusk 2 upgrade. Here you can see the main era blocks, the secondary era blocks in these strips, and pairs, and there's even a little bit of strap and pad detail on the inside of the secondary era blocks. And this is some armour for the commander's station and an armoured conduit that connects the 50 cal that is mounted over the main gun. And this sprue contains mostly the top of the hull. It's got some very fine detail here for the grills, but best of all it's got a very fine anti-slip texture moulded in the relevant places. You can see here that in front of the driver's hatch the anti-slip is missing, just like the real vehicle. And here you can see just how fine the anti-slip texture and the other details on the top of the hull are. This is one of the fuel fillers, and you can see it has the clips and also the stay there for the driver's hatch. And you can see the weld detail and the texture of the anti-slip coating. Very nice indeed. And here on the rear of the hull there's some other nice detail, the louvers, the anti-slip coating again, and some very crisply moulded casting numbers. The gun barrel is moulded in two halves like this, which is unfortunate, it'll leave a nasty seam line to get rid of. If we look inside the upper hull you can see it's got lots of these strange sort of half ejector pins all over the place, as well as a few little locations here that will need to be opened out for various options. These are all called out in the instructions, but you'll need to take care. Next up is the turret shell. It comes in two large pieces like this, and once again it's moulded very cleanly with a very nice anti-slip texture on it. You can see here just how neat the texture is and how neat the welds are as well. This is a very hard thing to replicate, so the fact that Meng have actually remembered to put it on is very welcome. And you can see that the detail extends to the rest of the turret top here. Some very fine casting here representing the weld lines. The base of the turret has some very nice detail as well. It hasn't been forgotten. And inside the turret, again, there's some call-outs for a few places where holes need to be drilled. So there's quite a few places here that are marked to be opened out. Again, the instructions tell you where these need to be. What is interesting though is, as well as these marks here for the M1A2 SEP, there's also some for the M1A1, which suggests that another kit is on the way for an earlier variant of the Abrams. The tracks for this kit are workable styrene tracks. You get four of these sprues in black plastic. These contain the track pads and inner pads, the pins that hold everything together, the guide teeth, And this thing here is a little jig to help you fit the whole thing together. A look at the inner pads here shows some very nice bolt detail there, very nice and crisp. And here we have the guide horns or guide teeth, again with very nice bolt detail, and they're all moulded hollow, which is very good to see. The Abrams track uses hollow guide horns like these. This is the first transparent sprue, and it has the armoured glass parts for the loaders and the commander's weapon stations. The second transparent sprue contains parts for the periscopes and sights. And the third transparent sprue contains parts for the headlights and taillights, as well as some more periscopes and some more sights. The first etch fret contains some mesh for the stowage baskets around the turret, as well as the SIP panels for the front of the turret and a few little ancillary details. The second etch fret contains these mesh parts for the engine deck. All of the etch parts on this kit are very, very thin. You can see they're already starting to curl even on the fret, so they need to be handled with a lot of care, but they should look very nice and detailed once they're on the model. And finally we have a decal sheet. This one has some very nice artwork for various Abrams tanks in black and yellow, as well as some general sort of stencils that are common to all the tanks, and a few markings and names that will pick out particular vehicles. Okay, so that's the kit out of the way, but now let's take a look at this companion book, the M1A2 SEP Abrams main battle tank in detail. Now this is 104 pages, as it says, and almost 300 photographs in full colour. It's published by a new company, SABOT Publications of the US, and as you can see, it also has the Meng logo on it. I think Meng have sponsored this as a companion to their kit. So, let's have a look inside it. So, if it starts with me to go on with adverts for Meng, and a quick history there of the M1A2 SEP, and then some more description of the tank as it is made in the kit, and then onto some photographs. Now you'll perhaps remember that this particular markings option is included in the decals in the kit, and then we're on to basically just lots and lots of photos of the M1A2 in action and in various stages of maintenance. There are quite a few captions. They're all really quite useful. And they sort of explain what it is you're looking at, which is always useful. There's a lot of lumps and bumps on modern tanks, and it's hard often to tell. Here you can see the anti-slip texture. Some very nice views of the loaders and gunners' weapon stations. Walk round of the whole thing, showing things like the CIP panels. And then what's coming next is the M9 ACE book, which will be handy for the builders of the take-on kit. So there we go, that's the companion book for this kit. Very useful for building this kit, but not just for this kit. Any M1A2 SEP kit will probably benefit from the details in this book. I was impressed with it. Not cheap, but then printed material isn't nowadays. And that brings us on to the last thing we're going to look at, which is this new paint set. This is the US Modern Vehicles colour set, and as you can see, it has the same box artwork as the Meng kit, and in fact it's labelled here as Meng Colour, the first set of Meng Colour paints, although the giveaway is manufactured by AK Interactive. The set contains these three shades of US Desert Tan for sort of modulation effects. It also has rubber black for tyres and mudguards and things, a light greyish green, which I think is just an interior colour, and this olive green, which is a base colour that's used often underneath the desert tan. These all look like fairly ordinary AK Interactive paints. They don't come with those little stainless steel stirring thingies in them, and they seem to have red lids to differentiate them from the usual AK Interactive paints. So I will try these at some point, but I assume that they'll just be ordinary AK Interactive style paints. Again, not essential, but very handy, especially the interior green. So there we have it. That's Meng's new kit of the M1A2 Abrams. I think it's going to be a fairly epic build. There's a lot of detail in there, and from comparing it to the photos in the book that I've also looked at, it does seem to be pretty accurate. I think Meng have really done the homework on this one and tried very hard to make it the best kit that you can get. The paint set, that's interesting as well. If you don't already have these paints in your collection, this is probably a good way to get them. If you have, I wouldn't worry about it. There's nothing really particularly special about it. Being able to have the three desert tans to give you colour modulation effects is only really of interest to the people who are interested in doing colour modulation. But for me, the interior green is quite useful. You don't seem to be able to get that anywhere else. And the other paints also are handy for not just US vehicles, but basically anything with tyres. So I'm very pleased with those. I hope you've found the review to be interesting, and I'm keen to know what you thought. Okay, that's it for now. So until the next time, happy modelling and goodbye.